I've probably poisoned more patients than I've cured. Over the last 30 years, I've had thousands of conversations with clinicians, patients, and the public. Over the next 15 minutes, I'll share with you my insights and observations on medicines, people, and the planet. So that sentence, I've probably poisoned more patients than I've cured. What words jump out at people? Well, the first word people are drawn to is the word poisoned.
Yes.
Because poisoning people doesn't sound that nice. Next, it's the word cured. But actually, we don't do as much curing as we'd like. And then there's the word probably. I've probably poisoned more patients than I've cured. It's a quote from a medical colleague of mine to highlight we work in a system where we don't really understand the true impact we may be having. Here's what we do know. Medicines play a crucial role in our lives. Prescribing a medicine is the most common intervention we make in healthcare. In the UK, we spend approaching £25 billion on medicines each year. And for the National Health Service, that's the biggest spend after staff costs. We also know that our use of medicines today are having a huge impact on the planet we leave behind for future generations. There can be pitfalls in prescribing. There's the trap of overdiagnosis and overtreatment. Patients with multiple long-term conditions often attract multiple specialists, the single organologists. And there are increased risk of a prescribing cascade. Let me show you what I mean by a prescribing cascade. I'll introduce you to Molly. Molly keeps her medicines. Molly's not in the box, am I? Molly keeps her medicines in a standard issue 2-litre ice cream tub, like many, many patients. Molly consults for a painful knee. She's 62 years of age, and so she's prescribed naproxen, an anti-inflammatory. Now, the guidelines say that Molly should also receive some gastroprotection to protect her from the harmful effects of the naproxen. So she's also prescribed some omeprazole. Now, the naproxen helps Molly with the pain, yes, but just increases her blood pressure just enough that now the guidelines suggest we should consider treating that. So Molly's prescribed some amlodipine to lower her blood pressure. The amlodipine helps with the blood pressure, but causes some ankle swelling. So Molly is prescribed a water tablet to help with the ankle swelling. Now this nudges Molly into urinary incontinence, but it's okay, we've got something for that. So Molly is prescribed oxybutynin. Now the oxybutynin leaves Molly confused, slightly unsteady on her feet, and at an increased risk of falls. Before we know it, Molly is the victim of a classic prescribing cascade and is now taking 5 medicines. We call that polypharmacy. Polypharmacy is often appropriate, but can sometimes become problematic. As we add medicines, we risk experiencing the law of diminishing returns. What do we think we're going to achieve when we add medicines 9, 10, and 11 to an individual? Or medicines 19, 20, and 21. Maybe to your parents, grandparents, or loved ones. Over 1 million people in the UK now take 10 or more medicines daily. And as each medicine we add for Molly, her risk of side effects increases, her risk of drug interactions increases, and her risk of hospitalisation due to her medicines increases too. Some quick sums, and we can say 1,000 pills are taken every second in the UK. Or are they? Take one tablet 3 times a day. Inhale 2 puffs twice a day. How hard can it be? When it comes to our medicines, we do the strangest things. We collect them, we hoard them, we share them with our neighbours, and we sell them. And when it comes to our medication-taking behaviour, we can't help but add our own flair to proceedings, our own internal logic. This is a training inhaler. We use inhalers to treat asthma and chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Let me show you 3 ways how not to use it. Up to 50% of our medicines are not taken as intended, which leads to £300 million worth of wasted medicines in the UK. So why don't patients take their medicines? Well, it turns out it's not so straightforward. Medicines turn people into patients. And it's hard work being a patient. It comes with a treatment burden. Hospital visits, clinic appointments, blood tests, side effects, car parking. Our beliefs about medicines matter too. Prescribing a medicine affects a person's sense of self. And we know that the context of a patient's daily life is more important in the effective use of medicines than merely prescribing the right medicine and explaining how to take it. And that an informed patient does not mean an obedient one. Patients have doubts and concerns. They have doubts about the necessity and concerns about the potential adverse effects. Those doubts and concerns are well founded. Medicines may cause harm. Yeah, medicines may cause harm, side effects and adverse drug reactions. Medicines are implicated in 16.5% of all hospital admissions. That's 16.5% of all unplanned hospital admissions in the UK where a medicine is the primary or contributing cause. So do our medicines work? Well, not as well as people may expect. Many of our medicines don't have the levels of effectiveness that patients expect. And both as clinicians and patients, we're guilty of overestimating the benefits and underestimating the harms. Most of our medicines don't work in most of our patients most of the time. That's a quote from a pharmaceutical company senior executive. And they're correct. Most of our medicines don't work in most of our patients most of the time. Now that quote from 2003 was preparing us for pharmacogenomics, the personalisation of medicines, which 20 years on is still a work in progress. So just to remind you, prescribing a medicine is the most common intervention we make in healthcare. But what about deprescribing? Deprescribing is the process of stopping medicines or reducing the dose of medicines that we no longer require or where the risk of harm outweighs the benefit for the patient taking them, where we may be doing more harm than good. Stopping medicines can have a profound impact. There's the case of Mabel, an 87-year-old grandmum with vascular dementia. She's prescribed a cocktail of five psychotropic medicines that have robbed her of her ability to interact with her friends and family, to move independently and do the things that she used to enjoy. On admission, she is sat slumped in a chair, slurring her speech, drooling saliva, unable to interact. Following medication review and deprescribing, Molly became able to interact with staff, friends and family, became able to move independently, and much to the delight of her son, daughter and grandchildren, started playing beautiful pieces on the piano from memory. And then there's the case of Joan Whitelaw. Joan's medication review, also a grandmum with vascular dementia. Joan's medication review and subsequent deprescribing meant that she was able to call her son Tommy by his name for the first time in 18 months. Tommy told us that that medication review gave my mum back to me. So, for those of you watching this who are considering getting older, what can we do? Well, our big hope is shared decision-making. As a patient, involve me in the decision-making process. Now, not everybody wants to be involved, and some don't have the capacity or the health literacy to be involved. But BRAN is a great place to start. B-R-A-N. BRAN. What are the benefits? What are the risks? What are the alternatives? And what if we do nothing? How else can we improve things? Well, we can reframe narrow what is the matter conversations with broader, more meaningful what matters conversations. And whilst acknowledging that some polypharmacy is appropriate and inevitable, We can remind clinicians that when it comes to decisions about their medicines and prescribing, that they're asked to follow guidelines, not rigid tram lines. And as patients and carers, we can ask for and sometimes insist on a medication review and possibly deprescribing. So in this highly medicated world, there will be unintended consequences. I mentioned the planet earlier. My introduction to the ecological damage caused by medicines came in 2004 when I read about the 95% decline in vultures, the vulture population in India. The decline happened because the vultures were feeding on the carcasses of cattle that had been treated with diclofenac, a popular anti-inflammatory used in humans and animals. The birds died of kidney failure in their millions. Without vultures clearing up rotting carcasses, disease spreads. The impact? 500,000 human deaths over 5 years. Now my area of interest extends to medicines in our water, in our rivers and in our oceans. So what does happen to our medicines? That 25 billion we spend, the 300 million we're not using and we waste, where does it end up? Well, down the drain. Literally, down the drain. The ones we take out of our bodies, into the sewage system, and into our rivers, estuaries, and oceans. The ones that we're not taking, they have a more direct route sometimes, as they bypass the bladder and the bowels, and are sometimes flushed directly into the system. So what does the evidence say? Well, one study looked at pharmaceutical pollution in over 1,000 rivers around the world. A second study, a bit closer to home, looked at pharmaceutical pollution in 37 rivers in 10 English national parks. And what did they find? Active pharmaceutical ingredients in our water. Antibiotics, antidepressants and antihistamines. Hormones and pain relievers. Caffeine. Carbamazepine used in epilepsy. Metformin used in diabetes. Paracetamol too, in tiny amounts, but there. Clarithromycin, an antibiotic, at above safe levels. So what? What about the impact? Well, for humans, uncertain, probably, is that word again. But it's not great news for our fish, frogs, and invertebrates. We're poisoning them. There's that word again. The impacts on wildlife include mortality and changes to behaviour, physiology, and reproduction. For example, oral contraceptives can cause the feminization of fish and amphibians. Residuals of psychotropic medicines can alter fish behaviour. And the improper disposal of antibiotics can contribute to antimicrobial resistance and possibly treatment failure. So what? We're recording this TEDx in Wales, where we have the Future Generations Act, which urges us to look at the long-term impact of the decisions we make. So what can be done? Well, for the pharmaceutical industry, there's an urgent need to design greener drugs, so-called benign by design. And the water industry needs to improve its wastewater processes, more in line with Switzerland. And what can we do? Well, as patients, we can get ready for shared decision-making. And those medicines we're not taking or no longer need, we can return them to our pharmacies. We don't need to flush them down the toilet. We don't need to put them down the sink. We don't need to put them out for our black bag waste. We can return them to our pharmacies. You know, the inhaler I showed you earlier? This has a carbon footprint equivalent to driving a small car the 175 miles from here to London. But that's for another time. I'll leave you with one last case study. A gentleman consults his clinician, complaining of shortness of breath and a tight chest. The clinician says to the man, "I think your cat is giving you asthma. I'm going to prescribe an asthma pump for you." And the gentleman has been spraying his cat with his inhaler. Thank you for listening.